So this series of videos, and I hope the viewer has patience to view them all, because I think these are some of the most important videos I ever filmed. You know, these videos I'm going to try to give a clear picture of Wing Chun's true history, and also explain some motivations for me doing the research and why I traveled to whole of Southeast Asia. And you know, this will be a companion videos to a book I'm currently writing that I hope to bring out somewhere in 2015, you know, maybe even in 2014, but how my schedule looks like now, I think that's almost impossible. But I think it's very, very important for people to realize what I'm saying on these videos. You know, they always say, oh, nobody has all the answers, nobody knows the complete truth about Wing Chun's history. Yes, that's true, we were not there, I was not there, but we have facts. We have clear facts. We have writings from the 1890s, we have writings from around the 1850s. Yeah, we have clear documented facts, so we can get a clear picture of Wing Chun's evolution. And I dare to say that 99% of the people out there have really a wrong view of Wing Chun's history. You know, they believe in the Yin Wing Chun story and Ung Mui seeing a crane and a snake fight and then came up with a new fighting system, or they believe in other stories, you know, and that there are some fake lineages out there who I exposed, by the way. No one to mention any names now again will only make them more famous. You know, that they spreading huge loads of misinformation out there doesn't help the fact, yeah. We have some very, very, very good researchers out there and people out there that are on the same wavelength like me and even helped me along the way with my research. Yeah, talking about people like Hendrik Santo and people like Sifu Robert Chu, who really know what they're talking about, you know, and they prefer to stay in the background. And I see it as my mission to bring out Wing Chun's true history. Because, you know, if we don't know, you know, we don't know where we're going, if we don't know where we're coming from, you know, I think it's very, very important. So, I've been coming to Hong Kong from 20 years ago, you know, and I did a lot of research in the beginning, but all stuck in the Yip Man lineage, you know, and there's only so far you can go. You know, like I mentioned on one of my earlier videos, you know, that you can see here up. Yeah, about is Yip Man lineage really a pure lineage? You know, then you start to realize, if you see that video, that you have to look beyond Yip Man's Wing Chun to find out the origin of our system. And then you end up first thing in China, of course. Now you have some friends of mine in the US and in Europe, and they say, Yeah, but I touch hands with the China guys, with the Yun Kai San lineage and stuff, and the China Wing Chun, and we are much better, you know. Our Yip Man Wing Chun is superior, so I don't agree with everything you're saying. You're a good researcher, but yes, you know, but you have to know some facts. I agree, the level of China Wing Chun nowadays is not that high. There are several reasons for that, you know, but one of the reasons is all the political trouble China had in the past. And we're talking about the Cultural Revolution, where so many Kung Fu systems totally perished, totally were destroyed, you know, and people, the many, many Kung Fu masters and Wing Chun masters were even hanged in squares. And you have a lot of these Kung Fu grandmasters that fled China. They went to Taiwan, they went to Malaysia, they went to Indonesia, to Philippines, to Vietnam. So that's the reason that if you go now to, for example, Taiwan, you find a much, much higher quality of Kung Fu than in mainland China. I dare to say that more than 90% of the Kung Fu, the good quality Kung Fu, is just gone. But we still find some clues there. We feel still find some people practicing Wing Chun there. And we need these keys in order to find the truth. And so I agree, you know, a lot of Wing Chun nowadays in Europe and in USA is of a higher quality than what you can find in mainland China. But that's beside the point. First of all, I did all my research in Hong Kong and did with many different Yip Man students and touched hands and interviewed. And of course, there's a huge quality difference also, but that's all topic for another video. But then we look at where did Yip Man get his art from, right? So a little bit in Dai Dat Lang, that you can very clearly trace back. And then most of his information he clearly got from Yun Kaisan. And then you go to a, like, you bump into a stop there, you know, you bump into a wall. What is beyond Yun Kaisan or before Yun Kaisan? You know, we know Phuc Bo Chun, for example, you know, was famous for his double knife techniques. And then what's before Phuc Bo Chun? Then we run into all these legends. You know, where did Wing Chun come from? What is the origin of the system? On which Kung Fu systems it's based on? You know, this is a very, very important question. You know, a lot of Kung Fu systems, like I mentioned before, got lost during several instances in the Chinese history. You know, for example, the Cultural Revolution, but also during instances in the 1800s. And that's when these Kung Fu masters fled China and went into other countries of Southeast Asia. Now, to see where Wing Chun originates from, we have to go back further and further in time, right? And luckily, through hard work of several people, you know, and one, like I mentioned before, Hendrik Santo, who had the luck to study Wing Chun in the Chou family, and that his Sifu passed on several documents to him. You know, is our luck that through these happenings in history that we can trace back all the way back to Wing Chun's origins. You know? And of course, like I mentioned before, we were not there. So we don't know exactly what happened. But we do have very clear facts and documents to at least present and show this is Wing Chun's DNA. These are the Kun Kuts. These are the poems. This is what the theory is based on. And then you can trace it and you come to a conclusion, which is, at least to me and to Sifu Robert Chu and to Hendrik Santo and to Jim Rosalindo, you know, and some other people out there, very, very, very clear. You know, Wing Chun is based upon two main systems. First of all, Fujian White Crane, you know, and to go into the Fujian White Crane, let me very clearly in between tell something about that. You know, the Fujian White Crane is victim to the same incidents in Chinese history. If we look at Fujian White Crane nowadays in Yongchun Village, is nowhere near of the quality of the original Fujian White Crane. You know, the original White Crane system before it got split into several systems, it was one very compact system. And for example, nowadays here in Hong Kong, we have a great grandmaster, you know, Lei Kong, who is really able to demonstrate White Crane in all its effectiveness. And if you compare that to the White Crane that's being taught nowadays in China, in Yongchun Village, there is so much difference, so big difference in quality. Another place where we can find really, really good White Crane is in Taiwan. You know, great martial artists, they're great white grandmasters there. But in mainland China nowadays, almost all gone. So the systems on which Wing Chun is based are Fujian white crane
and Erme, the martial arts form of Erme.